Good morning.
You don't have to mute me now.
So, sorry, there's this little thing. I forgot to get a microphone. Okay. But I have it now.
All right.
Not sure what I was thinking, but we'll deal with that when we're singing. Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, let's try that again. Myra needs to think there's 200 people in this sanctuary, so in order to do that, you'd be loud enough for the camera to pick that up. So ready? Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. We'll just cut out that part of the video, send it to him, and yeah. He just needs to know we got it under control. Not that I didn't have a microphone on when it was time for church to start, but that doesn't matter because I'm loud. You're here. We're ready to worship this morning. It is so good to have you here this morning to worship with us, whether you're new, whether you've been here forever. Thank you for being here, whether you're watching online. If you are new here, we do have connection cards in the seat back pockets in front of you. If you just want to grab that, fill that out, bring it to Paul or I at the end of the service, and we have a gift for you. And we would love to just welcome you, say hello. If you are not new, on the back of that is a place where you can take notes, or you can just share your prayer request. You can put that either in the offering plate or bring that to us, and we would love to go to the Lord in prayer on your behalf for whatever is weighing you down. We'd just love to intercede on your behalf for you. Just a couple of announcements this week, today. Wednesday is our end of summer pool party. Some of you already went back to school this week. Some of you are going next week. Some of you are going in another week. I don't know when you homeschoolers start back up, but you will be. I know, because your moms are talking about all that kind of stuff. So end of summer pool party will be Wednesday night at Forest Hill Swim Club at 5:30. And we'll have pizza and we'll just hang out and we'll just kind of end the summer in our normal pool party fashion. It is $8 to swim, and we'll have pizza. And if you can, let me know if you're coming, then I'll kind of know how much pizza to get. But we're super excited about not ending the summer. Okay, yes, we are. You didn't hear that, kids. We're not happy about ending the summer, but we are excited about getting together and fellowshipping at the pool. It's always one of my favorite times are when we get together at the pool and can just chit-chat and watch the kids. Taco Tuesday, this will be our last Taco Tuesday of the summer. Now, you Roanoke County kids, I'm sorry. You're going to miss it. You're at school. But for the rest of you who haven't gone back to school yet, we're going to meet at El Rio at high noon for tacos. Two tacos and water's on me. Anything else is on you. But let me know if you're coming so I know how big of a table to reserve, and we'll finish that Taco Tuesday out. And then tomorrow is our 12-hour prayer event. On the table in the vestibule is our list. There's a few spots, 15-minute spots, for the 12-hour prayer event if you have not yet signed up. We have a few spots. All we ask is that in that time that you take 15 minutes and just pray. If you're not sure, that's a long time. I can help you with that. Start with here, like praying for here and the nation and the president. And I promise you, as you start thinking of who to pray for, when you start with our church and our city and our nation and our president, people will start coming to your mind to pray for. But, and then it'll be 30 minutes and you'll be like, wow, where'd that go? And then you'll be depressed because there's all these people we have to pray for. But that is what the Bible says. When we come together and we pray, things happen. There's change that happens. So 15 minutes out there. And then also tomorrow night at 6:30, we're going to be meeting here in the sanctuary just for a brief time of prayer. So if you'd like to join us here so we pray together, that's at 6:30. It'll be here in the sanctuary. Won't be not very long at all. And I think end of summer break, so this is our pool party. Then we're going to take 2 weeks off, the 24th and the 31st. There will be no Wednesday night services, and we'll resume in September. We are so grateful for all the ways that you support the ministries here at the church. We just couldn't do that without your support, without your financial giving. So there's all the ways to give. The offering plate's in the back. You can text. You can do it online. You can send a check-in. We thank you for your obedience and all the ways that you help us continue to do what we do, to have the doors open. This gym is used all the time. Our buildings are used all the time. And we just could not do that without you. Last thing, there are some sermon bingo cards. Apparently, people liked that last week, so if you want a sermon bingo card, they're in the back, and I've got prizes. Bring me your bingo card at the end if you get a bingo. You don't have to yell it out. Just bring it to me at the end. I got prizes. So as we start this morning, let's just do just a scripture of praise as we just start our worship off this morning. And they were singing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb. Great and marvelous are your works, O Lord God the Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the nations. Who will not fear you, Lord, and glorify your name? For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship before you, for your righteous deeds have been revealed. Let's go to the Lord in prayer.
Father, we come to you this morning, and we thank you for this opportunity for us to be together again. And Lord, as we've heard in this scripture, you are mighty God, and you do great and wonderful things. And Lord, even though we don't see you working, we know you are. And even though at times we feel like we're all alone and all by ourselves, you're always there. And so, Father, this morning we thank you for this time that we can come together, that we can lift your voice and raise our voices and praise your name, and we can hear of your word and be filled up and charged up and sent back out into our community. So this morning, Father, we invite your presence into this place. Father, come. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Move in our hearts, move in our lives, so that this morning when we leave, we can be changed and renewed by your Spirit, Father. And we thank you for all these things. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you can, please stand to your feet, and we're going to raise our voices and worship our God this morning. Amen. If you remember to put both sheets of music out for anybody who ever wants to try this.
Or if you let the guy playing the piano play the instrumental before you start singing. We have established well this morning. The enemy is trying to stop what is happening in this church, but God is more powerful. We serve a mighty God.
Yes.
We have gathered here this morning. We have gathered with hands held, praying the enemy over, leaving this place, going where the Lord God would send him in the mighty name of Jesus, and knowing that our God is greater than anything we are dealing with today. I love this verse that Myra picked out. It said, let the peace of Christ keep you in tune with each other, in step with each other. God has given us one another. Thank you, Jesus. None of us going off and doing our own thing. And cultivate thankfulness. Let the word of Christ, the message, have the run of the house, our house. Give it plenty of room in your lives. Instruct and direct one another using good common sense. Thank you, Jesus. And sing your hearts into and out to God. Let every detail in your lives, words, actions, whatever, be done in the name of the Master, Jesus. Thanking God the Father every step of the way.
Amen. Give God
thank
praise.
You, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your word. God, thank you that you are the way maker, the promise keeper, the light in the darkness. Thank you, Jesus. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this.
4, 13 through 15 says, "We are not keeping this quiet, not on your life. Just like the psalmist who wrote, 'I believed it, so I said it.' We say what we believe. And what we believe is that the one who raised up the Master Jesus will just as certainly raise us up with you alive. Every detail works to your advantage and to God's glory. More and more grace, more and more people, more and more praise."
That's a good promise.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Father. God, we just proclaim right now that we believe this song. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit. We believe in God the Father. And we raise up the Trinity, Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit right now. And we just acknowledge your sovereignty. We acknowledge your providence, the way you work everything out, big and small, for our good. God, I just proclaim right now your promises. God, great is your faithfulness, and great are your promises. And you said you work all things for the good of those who love you and are called according to your purpose. And God, that is this church. That is the people in this building right now, their families. That is our pastor. Pray a special prayer over our pastor right now. And Mandy, God, we believe and we know you are bigger than any scheme or weapon that is formed against us. In the mighty name of Jesus, we believe that you are Jehovah Rapha, the Lord, our healer. We speak it over Mandy right now, over her belly, over her body. We proclaim healing, and that God, you will work all things for her good. And so right now, whatever you're teaching her, whatever you're trying to be to her right now in this trial that you have allowed, God, then we trust you with it, and we pray that it will work together for her good and for her body to be stronger, for her spirit to be stronger, for her mind to be stronger from this trial, Lord. And I know Mandy's not the only person suffering in this church. There's other people. There's people who have lost loved ones. There's people who are sick. There's people who have loved ones who are sick. There's people who we have established this morning who are fighting a spirit of fear. There are spirits of death. There are spirits of insecurity, spirits of anger. There are these spirits that we are very aware of, and we cast them out and rebuke them. We bind them and rebuke them in the name of Jesus right now, with the authority that has been given us, the power that has been given us because of the crucifixion, the resurrection, and the glorification of Jesus Christ. And we speak the victory of Christ over this church and every person that has anything to do with it in the mighty name of Jesus. Right now, we command the enemy to flee. The weapons that have been formed against us, the schemes that have been planned for our harm, we proclaim that God, you promised you would work them for our good. And so right now, we accept that, we receive that, that what was planned for our harm will work for our good. Because you said, and so I speak it over every person here. God, we believe. And we thank you that we are victorious in Christ, that we are nothing but victorious. We proclaim it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
So it is good to be back this week. We're going to dive in today. Now, if you're new here, know that I typically work with the teenagers. My name is Heather, and I am one of the pastors on staff here, and my primary role is to work with the teenagers. And every once in a while, I get to do Big Girl Church. This month, I get to do it all month long with Myron, our senior pastor, on sabbatical. And I'm always a little nervous. I take that back. I'm always nervous when I do Big Girl Church, because adults are a little different than teenagers. And I have very little problem telling teens some of my antics in my former life, to try to let them know that we were once teenagers. We weren't always fuddy-duddies, stick-in-the-muds, right? We did once have lives and get in trouble. Or at least I did. I don't know about the rest of you, but I did. So I have no problem, but it's hard for me to come and share some of my past antics with adults. But we're going to do that today. So One of the things that I was in my, and that you may not know, actually very few people know this about me unless I've shared it in a conversation, but one of the things in my before Christ life and that I've been delivered from, praise the Lord, is I was a chronic liar. And this started when I was young. And it went through right before I became, before I came to know Christ. But in my mind, my life just wasn't exciting enough. It was boring. My parents didn't, we didn't do fun. Looking back, we did all kinds of neat stuff. But I created these lives in my head. And so in the second grade, I shared with all of my classmates. Now, mind you, also, I'm an Army brat, so I move a lot. I was never in a school longer than 2 years. And so I have to make friends every time we move. So we had moved, I'm in the second grade, and I told all the kids in my class that Philip from Guiding Light was my big brother. Now, my mom watched Guiding Light. I knew all of the characters. Philip seemed to be the one that I was fixated on the most in the second grade, him and Michael Jackson, but we won't go there today. So I told all the kids in my class that Philip was my brother. I'm like, I don't know if you've ever seen this show, but Philip, that's my brother. And they would ask me, well, what's his name? Well, I didn't know then. Now I know it was Grant Alexander, but I didn't know that in second grade because I didn't watch the credits, nor could I probably read the, I mean, I read, but probably not the name. So I just told everybody when they would ask me that question that we just called him Philip because it was real confusing to go back from his set name to his real name. So we just called him Philip. And all of these, and every time they would ask questions, I just made up answers. Now that was second grade. Let's fast forward to middle school. I ate. My dad is a zebra cake fanatic. They were always in our house, and one day he went to get one and they were all gone. Now, we weren't allowed to have those just to have those as snacks. They were part of a lunch or, you know, we couldn't just go get them whenever we wanted. But I did, and my dad came home. They were all gone, and he said, he knew there was one left. He said, who ate the last zebra cake? Both my brother and I, my younger brother and I said, not me. Well, obviously one of us is lying. My dad knows this. He's not dumb. And so he said, well, until somebody fesses up, you're going to sit on the couch. So we did, for days. I've apologized at length to my brother, really, at this day and age, because he was punished a lot because of me. But we sat on that couch. My brother obviously wasn't going to confess because he didn't do it. I was stubborn and refused to confess, so I decided the best plan of action was to write a confession letter from my friend who happened to be over the day that the zebra cake went missing. So I wrote the confession letter. I came home from school, and before sitting down on the couch, which was our punishment, to just sit there on the couch, I gave it to my dad, and I said, Tori had the last zebra cake. Here's the letter. My dad read the letter. I did disguise my handwriting. I'm not stupid. My dad read the letter. He called Tori's parents. Then some more lies had to come out. I promise you that's not the best way to maintain a friendship, to throw your friend under the bus. And I think my dad finally just gave up. He knew it was me, but he just kind of gave up. But every time, I tell you these stories to tell you that every time I told a lie, I had to tell another lie until it got to the point where I didn't even know what the truth was anymore. And it's not something I'm proud of. It's not something I can handle today when other people lie. I have to take myself back and go, I used to be you. You know, so, but today, I'm on the flip side of that. I'm honest to a fault. I just tell you, I don't wanna, I'm honest to a fault. I'll throw myself under the bus. I'll tell you more than you needed to know because I'm just honest. And I'm so glad that I'm no longer that person. And I'm sure, maybe not, but I'd venture to say at some point in time, you've been caught in the web of lying like I have. Maybe not as often as I was, although I got really good at it there for a time. Or maybe you've heard the saying the ever-popular, oh, what a tangled web we weave, when at first we do deceive. Now, spider webs are super impressive if you think about them. They're intricately woven in the matter of what seems like minutes by spiders. If you've ever doubted that there's a God, there's lots of things that you can research, but spiders, just research spiders and what they do and how they do it. They shoot silk from their abdomen. I mean, is that not the coolest thing or what, right? There's no question that God has created these things. But a spider's web is remarkable. It's made from silk, woven from liquid, made from the glands inside their abdomen. Then, like I said, they shoot that, they make the web, and the strands of a spider web are very, very fine, frequently measuring about one one-hundred-thousandth of an inch in diameter. And they're so thin that in the past, they were often used as line markers in lenses of certain optical instruments. Now, as remarkable as they are, I think we all know how annoying spider webs can be. They make the corners of our rooms unsightly. There's nothing worse than walking into one and getting it all caught up in your hair. Monday, we were at the park with VBS, and one of the boys said, "Miss Heather, go down the big slide." First mistake. I got stuck. Second, we get down to the bottom after I got unstuck and Donald told me to lift my feet up and I'd go and we figured that all out. I was the first one, obviously, that had gone down the slide that morning because I face planted into a spider web with a spider still there. That was more than I needed on a Monday morning, right? All in the name of Jesus, right? Right? But we know how awful or annoying that is. But the spider's web is necessary if the spider is going to survive. The web serves as a net to capture food for the spider to eat. So along comes the unsuspecting insect buzzing around, living his best life, lands in the spider web, bam, stuck. Its wings get entangled in the web. It starts to flap its wings, as we would do when we get stuck somewhere. We would just flap our wings, if that were us. We'd flap our wings, but the more we're flapping our wings and twisting and turning, trying to free ourselves, the more we struggle, or the more it struggles to be free, the more trapped it becomes. And when it's completely caught, down drops the spider, wraps the insect with a few jets of silk, bites it to knock it out, and dinner is served. As we continue looking at each of these characters in the story of John, the beheading of John the Baptist, we meet a man who is trapped in a web and cannot get free. Let's revisit the story in Mark of John the Baptist. Mark chapter 6, starting in verse 14. King Herod heard about this, for Jesus' name had become well known. Some were saying, "John the Baptist has been raised from the dead, and that is why miraculous powers are at work in him." Others said, "He is Elijah." And still others claimed, "He is a prophet, like one of the prophets of long ago." But when Herod heard this, he said, "John, whom I beheaded, has been raised from the dead." For Herod himself had given orders to have John arrested, and he had him bound and put in prison. He did this because of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, whom he had married. For John had been saying to Herod, "It is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife." So Herodias nursed a grudge against John and wanted to kill him, but she was not able to, because Herod feared John and protected him, knowing him to be a righteous and holy man. When Herod heard John, he was greatly puzzled, yet he liked to listen to him. Finally, the opportune time came. On his birthday, Herod gave a banquet of his high officials for his high officials and military commanders and the leading men of Galilee. When the daughter of Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his dinner guests. The king said to the girl, "Ask me for anything you want, and I'll give it to you." And he promised her with an oath, "Whatever you ask, I will give you up to half of my kingdom." So she went out and said to her mother, "What shall I ask for?" "The head of John the Baptist," she answered. At once the girl hurried in to the king with the request, "I want you to give me right now the head of John the Baptist on a platter." The king was greatly distressed, but because of his oaths and his dinner guests, he did not want to refuse her. So he immediately sent an executioner with the orders to bring John's head. The man went, beheaded John in prison, and brought back his head on a platter. He presented it to the girl, and she gave it to her mother. On hearing of this, John's disciples came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. Like I said, we're going to get real familiar with this story over these 4 weeks in August. So John the Baptist calls Herod on his sin, which the sin is his marriage to Herodias. And some might say, well, why is that a problem? Well, let's break it down. Now follow along, because this is going to get crazy. So to start, Herodias is the daughter of a man named Aristobulus. Now, big deal. I don't know who Aristobulus is. You might not either. I'll tell you, though. He is Herod's half-brother. So that makes Herodias Herod's niece. So Herod goes to visit his brother in Rome, and that's where he meets Herodias. Now, at the time, she's married to Philip. Who's Philip? Herod's brother. So now she's the niece and the sister-in-law. So Herod, now he's a smooth operator, he devises a plan while he's there. He seduces her. He persuades her to leave Philip and to marry him. So this was not by accident. It's not one of those, well, it just happened stories. No, this was an act that was contrived. He had meant for it to happen. It was very thought out, planned out. It was a deliberate act on Herod's part. So if that's not daytime talk show enough for you, let me add on to that. Herod is also already married. Herod's married, so he has to divorce his current wife in order to marry Herodias. So in case you lost track, which would be easy to do in this little love story, Herodias is Herod's niece, sister-in-law, and now his wife. Have you ever heard the phrase, "I'm my own grandpa"? Right? So we got to follow along with the story. So it looks like Herod is a little tangled up, but he becomes more entangled. So in this passage, he's at a banquet for his birthday. And after one too many drinks, which is how all good stories start, I'm told, Salome comes out to dance for Herod and his guests. Salome is Herodias' daughter. She's also Herod's niece, grandniece, and now his stepdaughter. So, this is not, when Salome comes out to dance for Herod and his guests, this is not ballroom dancing. It's a little too spicy for Dancing with the Stars. In fact, this is kids cover your eyes kind of dancing, okay? So, Herod, obviously, with the spicy dancing, becomes lustful. And after that, he offers Salome anything she wants, only caveat, just up to half of my kingdom. Let's not get overzealous here, right? So up to half my kingdom. So this web of sin closed tighter and tighter, starting to suffocating Herod. He was caught, but he refused to do what was necessary to be set free. And now we see the story start to spiral. Because now, the story doesn't end with the actual sin, because now he's caught in the web of guilt. He's feeling guilty about his relationship with Herodias. He's realized that what John the Baptist said was true, but he couldn't bring himself to have John put to death. He's just thrown him in jail. Because remember from last week, he said he's a righteous and holy man. He's figured this out about John. But the guilt just continues to grow. Psalm 139 tells us that God knows our hearts. And if we're not careful, we get trapped in this web of sin and guilt. If we're not of sober mind, not of we're drinking all the time, but just sober mind, making sure that we're not focused on all the things of the world, that we may get caught on this, in the web and be devoured. And we see that in 1 Peter that said that you, if you're not of sober mind, be careful, be on watch. Herod reminds me a lot of the main character in Edgar Allan Poe's short story, The Telltale Heart. Now, this was a favorite when I taught English. This was a favorite when we did Poe, our unit on Poe. And it's very disturbing. If you've never read it, read it. It's very disturbing, but it was one of my kids' favorites because it was so relatable. And the story goes like this. The main character commits murder, and he buries the body in the floorboards of his house. The problem is he starts to feel guilty, and he's so filled with guilt that all he can hear is the heartbeat of the dead man that's in the floor. Okay, so he's just guilty. So his subconscious is hearing this heartbeat, and it just keeps getting louder and louder and louder. And then the police come because the neighbor's gone missing. And so the police come just to ask him some questions, like, have you seen the neighbor? But the heartbeat is so loud, and his conscience hears it so loud, he couldn't stand it anymore. And right there to the police, he confesses his act of murder. All because of his conscious and the guilt that he felt for this. So Herod, we see he's trying to run from his conscience. And I think about the novels I love to read, and Bill and I, and we like to watch the crime detective shows, and I think about all the bad guys who are on the run. Sometimes the good guys have to be on the run too, but I think about the people who are on the run, who are trying to run from getting caught or being whatever that looks like. And they, whatever they're running from, whatever they're being chased by, they really can't rest. They really can't stop. Because it's when they stop or they rest or they take a break, it's when they make a stupid mistake and they get caught. Because they're just not thinking. And they're just tired. And that's when they get captured. It's like something's haunting them and coming after them. And haunted is the best description of the heart and the mind that's consumed by guilt. Always looking over your shoulder, wondering, am I about to be found out? Did somebody see me? Did I do something wrong that somebody knows about now? And David talked about that guilt in Psalm 31 when he said, my strength fails because my affliction and my bones grow weak. You see, when we accept Christ, when we say that we believe in Christ, we believe that he died and rose again for our sins, that's what's called justification. We're justified. We have sin. We're going to heaven. We're spending an eternity in heaven. But there's one step further, which is what we're working on, and we're working through these 4 weeks. When we're seeking, we know when we accept Christ that first time and the party's happening in heaven, we know that we're forgiven of our sin. We know that. That's what we've acknowledged. But it doesn't stop us from going, am I going to do that again? Or feeling guilty about what we might have done. For a long time, I lived with the shame and the guilt of who I was as a liar. I know now that I've been delivered from that. I don't have to worry about that anymore. That's not who I am. But when we're building our relationship with God, as we're continuing to mature in Christ, when we're seeking holiness, or this other big word, sanctification, we'll just stick to holiness. It sounds much better. We're working toward a life where we are free from our carnal knowledge of sin, or meaning we get to a place as we enter into and as we work toward holiness, that we get to a place where we don't intentionally sin every day. Now, are we still gonna sin? Yes, we're all born sinners, that's the deal. But we work toward a place where we're not intentionally sinning. And that's the key word there, intentional. We can look back at the past and know that guilt no longer has us trapped in this web. Because according in Romans 1, it says the removal of guilt comes from trusting in Jesus. And in order to trust in someone, you have a relationship with them. That's where the real trust comes from. Because we cannot have guilt and hope at the same time. We can't. We cannot have guilt and hope at the same time. Guilt slowly eats away at our spiritual life. It slowly eats away at our, at just our spirit, and it eats away at our life. In Herod's case, it did start with a sin. He was caught in a web of sin, which led to a web of guilt. And then it doesn't stop there. It continues to spiral because Herod gets caught in the web of pride. Salome came back to Herod and demanded John the Baptist's head on a plate. And it was at that moment that Herod goes, uh-oh, I made a mistake. And when he realized that instead of confessing, he went through with it. He was concerned with what his dinner guests thought and not what God thought. And there it is, pride. And we're all too familiar with the web of pride. It hinders a lot of us from admitting that we're wrong. It destroys relationships, friendships, marriages. Relationships in the workforce with coworker, boss, it ruins things. It destroys things. Because of, instead of making amends, we buck up like a pit bull. We buck up like this pit bull with the determination to never back down, no matter the cost. We're going to fight until we win, and it doesn't matter at what cost. And we know that pride comes before the fall. And so for Herod, we have this list of adultery, lust, guilt, fear, murder, and now pride. And obsession with guilt. All because he wouldn't confess his sin. Because it could have been avoided. All he had to do was admit that he was wrong. All he had to do was confess his sin. Now, I don't know what web you might be trapped in right now. It might not be as flagrant as Herod's, but we all have webs that we get trapped in. In our minds, or hidden away in a dark corner of our heart, we have some secret that's lurking there like a hidden spider. And we've accepted Christ, and we've said, hey, I'm with you, God. But we haven't given him full access to every nook and cranny of our heart. It's like when people come over for the first time, you know, there's those levels of friendships. When you come in, you sit in the living room because that's what you got cleaned up before they came over, but they're not going to go into the kitchen, or they're not going to, the doors are closed to the bedrooms because they're not cleaned up. Or maybe you have friends that are, yeah, they're good friends, and they get to see the messy bedrooms because, you know, they're hot messes like you are. I'm just speaking from experience. I don't know how. Your houses are probably immaculate. Mine's not. Sorry, Bill. But there's always that one place that nobody's allowed to go. It's the darkest of closets. And our heart's the same way with God. Have we given him, have we entered, asked him to come in and revealed all of that to him? Newsflash, he already knows. You're not keeping it a secret. But have we said, yes, God, here? We tell ourselves with whatever this is that we've not confessed to anybody else. We tell ourselves the secret that it doesn't affect anybody else. We've convinced ourselves it's not hurting anybody. So it should be okay. It's fine. It's fine. And before we realize it, we're trapped. And we're caught in this self-defeating web. And suddenly, actually not suddenly, sometimes it might happen suddenly, but more often than not, all of a sudden, we realize that we're a million miles away from God. Or at least, it feels like we are. We're the ones that moved, he hasn't. And instead of letting go, we hold on to it. Now in South America and Africa and Asia, the natives have come up with a ingenious way to trap monkeys. It's very effective. They take a gourd or a similar object and they drill a hole in it just large enough for the monkey's hand to pass through. So once they do that, they put some sand or some rocks in it to weight it down. Then they put a nut or a piece of fruit in there, and they leave it sit there with a trap over top or a trap from the bottom, however they're going to pull it up or drop it down or whatever, however they're going to. But they put it, the monkey doesn't see that, and the monkey comes along again, living its best life. Ooh, a nut. And he sticks his hand in the gourd, and he grabs the nut, and when he comes to pull his hand out, because he's holding on to this, he cannot pull his hand out. Now, the gourd's too heavy. He can't lift it up and go and move it. And so he's trapped. He can't get it back. And because he won't let go, then the net comes up or falls down and gets the monkey. And he gives up his freedom to hold on to this small piece of food. And it seems silly, but ask yourself, what are you holding on to that has you trapped? Herod was caught, but he refused to do what was necessary to be set free. When COVID first started, I was angry. I didn't have the peace and the joy of the Lord because I was angry with everybody. I don't care if you were Republican or Democrat, vaxxer, anti-vaxxer, mask, anti-mask. I was angry with all of you. Not you, necessarily. But I was angry. And I came to this altar, I can't tell you how many times, just angry. And it hindered my relationship with God. On Sundays, I'd come and I'd say, God, you got to take this anger away from me. I'm angry. And it just didn't go away. Mandy stood up here one day and yelled at me. She's literally in church. She said, right here, as I told her, I said, I'm so angry. And she said, there's nothing you can do to control that. You have got to let that go. And it wasn't very nice, but that's, Mandy and I have that relationship. She can yell at me. And I had to realize it was outside of my control. But my anger had me tangled in this web that didn't allow me to have that relationship with God that I desire. It didn't affect my salvation. I was angry. I still believed in Jesus. It didn't affect that, but it halted me from moving to a place of holiness and being holy. I could not work on being holy like my Heavenly Father was holy. Oh, there's that holy verse again. Be holy as He is holy. It's not a suggestion. Hey, if you have some time, work on being holy. Add that to your to-do list. It's to do. But what we don't realize with all the translations from Greek to English is that holy in that verse are two different words. You see, when it says be holy as He is holy, as God is holy, that's hagios. It means blameless or perfect. That's what God is. He's blameless or perfect. But that word holy is not the same for us when it says be holy, you be holy. That word is teleos. And what that means is to become mature. Not perfect, mature. And so for a period, I was just angry. And I didn't want to let that anger go. Because I'm sure some of you know, sometimes it just feels good to be angry. I didn't want to let that go. I was holding on to that. And it affected my spiritual walk. It affected those that were around me. I knew, but I wasn't willing to let it go. So maybe that's where you are today. Maybe there's someone that you need to forgive, that you're just holding on to the unforgiveness. And it's hindering you from really drawing close to God. Or maybe your pride is going before you at work or at school. Maybe you're harboring guilt about something that you don't really need to be. But do you want to know? And that's so negative and dark. And so let me flip the narrative for you a little bit. Do you want to know what it looks like when putting making it right ahead of guilt and pride? I'll tell you the story of another king. By most standards, he was a great king. He was a warrior. And through those skills, it enabled his country to go powerful and to receive a certain amount of respect. And one day he was out walking on his roof and he looked across and there was a pretty little thing taking a bath. And he said to his attendants, go get her. And his attendants went and brought the woman to him. Then he learned she was married, but that didn't really stop him. But then they got caught because she's pregnant. Now, nobody knows about it yet, so this could ruin this king, finding out that this other married woman is now pregnant. So what's a man to do? Well, the only obvious thing, cover it up. So he devised a plan to bring her husband back, one of his most loyal soldiers from battle, bring her husband back from battle. They can spend some time together, and then there would be no question on who the baby daddy is, okay? No question. Except his soldier is loyal, and he says, no, I'm fighting this battle for you and for our country. I'm not coming back. Oh, okay. So now what are we going to do? Well, obviously, devise another plan to cover up the sin. So he sits down, he pens orders that they are to send this soldier, this loyal soldier, into battle to the front lines. And when the soldiers get him to the front lines, everybody else is supposed to retreat, leaving him vulnerable. And so he signs the order, he hands it to his loyal soldier, basically having him deliver his own declaration of execution. And then he waited for word that the deed was done. And it came. And then one day, a preacher showed up on the king's doorstep. And in a dramatic way, he pointed out the king's evil ways, much like John the Baptist did for Herod. And he pointed out his evil ways. And here's where we see the difference between Herod and King David. David confessed his sin. He was caught in the same spiral of sin and guilt, but he cried out to God, "Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me." He prayed to God what we now see in Psalm 32, verses 3 through 5. "When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy on me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin." When we are trapped in these webs, we cannot draw closer to God. We cannot say that we're in the process of becoming holy. What makes us holy? Not this list of things to do or not do. That's not what it is. To become holy, step one, that it's not a list of rights and wrongs and things to do and to not do. We have a choice. Like Herod, we can allow our pride to prevent us from confessing our sins and have a defeated life from now on. We can choose that route. Or we can be like David. We can confess our sin and be restored a right relationship with God, to continue walking on that path, knowing that we're going to sin, but we're going to confess that and we're going to do right and we're going to continue on that path with God. We can give God every part of us, confessing even the worst, opening the door to that closet that got the smelly stuff in it and saying, "Here you go, God, here's the closet too." Confessing even the worst of things. And it's only because it's only when we surrender all of us, every piece of us, every part of us, the sin, the secret sin, the not so secret sin, it's not until we do that that we can truly work on being holy as He is holy. We have to do that so God can do what He does. We have no part in becoming holy short of saying, "Here I am, God." And then God does what God does. Because God is God and He is amazing. And He works in us and He works through us. But it starts with us saying, "Okay, here it is." So today, the only question I have for you is, who do you want to be like? Do you want to be like Herod? Or do you want to be like David, a man after God's own heart? As we finish out today, there's a song that's going to play, and the altars are open. And again, I tell you, you don't have to come to the altar. You can do it in your seat. Coming to the altar is just a way of you coming forth to God and saying, "Here I am. And I know that's hard sometimes because the human part of us says, oh, I'm at the altar. They're going to think I did something awful. Well, you might have. Who cares? Or you might just be up here saying, God, reveal to me what I need to know, what I need to get rid of. Because maybe you haven't figured out that you've got something you're holding on to. Maybe you don't know that you're holding on to it. I didn't know I was holding on to anger until Mandy said, you got to let that go. I couldn't comprehend what it was doing to me and to the people around me. So can you meet with God in your seat? Absolutely. He'll meet you wherever you are. But to come forward to these altars is just another step in saying, God, I want to be holy like you're holy. And I might know what I need to get rid of, and I don't know how I'm going to do that, but I know that I could do that with you. Or it might be, God, reveal to me what's in that closet that I'm not ready to open up. Because he knows, and he will. The altars are open.
Blessing fall on me.
Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning surrendering. Whether it be for the first time that we've ever said, Lord, I surrender, I give in, I'm tired of having this arm wrestling match with you, and I want you to be the Lord of my life, and I accept what you did for me. I know that you died for me on the cross, and I've confessed my sins. Whether it's the first time that we've ever surrendered to you at all, or whether it's the second time we've surrendered, or whether it's the time that we have finally come and said, hey, I've been doing this thing for a while, but I'm all in. And so, Lord, we come to you this morning, and we just, here we are. Maybe some of us aren't there yet, Lord. And so today, and that's okay, Lord. I know you meet us where we are. And so all I ask today of you, Lord, is that you just, as we're going throughout our week, that you would just send us little nudges and little hints. Or maybe, Lord, we just need a 2x4 obviousness of where we need to surrender, Lord. What it is that's holding us, truly holding us back from you. And so, Lord, I just ask that you will just meet us where we are the entire week in everything that we're doing. Pierce our hearts if we're getting ready to do something that is not holy and pleasing to you. Lord, help us this week when we're trying to be a Herod, that we just think of David and we become a David and we just say, hey, I messed up, I'm really sorry. That we don't get entangled in these webs of sin and guilt and pride, Lord. That the minute we feel trapped, that we don't just keep fighting, we just say, I'm sorry. And we start over. And it might mean that we need to start over 17 times in a day, and that's okay. Because at the end of the day, Lord, we know. We know that you love us. So, Lord, be with each of us as we leave this place today. Help us to be more like David's. So that we know and we will hear you say one day, well done, good and faithful servant, that we too may be people after your own heart. It's in your precious name we pray. Amen. Now, if you'll stand for the benediction. As you leave, bring me your bingo cards. I got prizes. Or not. If you don't have a prize, that's fine too. No judgment. You don't need to confess that to me. It's fine. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Holy Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know that this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now, to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Have a wonderful week. Mm-hmm. I'm Rachel and Ethan.